Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we're going to look at chemical shift within the aromatic region. So we're talking about between roughly 7 and 8 parts per million on a proton NMR. That is where protons that are attached to a benzene ring or a benzene derivative will show up. So benzene itself is symmetrical. It has only one signal and the chemical shift is about 7.3 ppm. But if there are substituents on the benzene ring, which of course there will be as we look at more complicated molecules, those will influence where within that region the signal shows up. And so we want to learn some systematic ways that we can predict how chemical shift will be impacted by the presence of a substituent. We can break down substituents into two different types, substituents that are electron donating and substituents that are electron withdrawing. So we'll look at electron donating substituents first. Those are substituents that push electron density into the ring. So they make it a more electron-rich environment and a more shielded environment. So generically speaking, if we have a benzene ring and there's some X group on it, it's going to push electron density into the ring. And that can either be done via resonance or induction. And this is going to make the ring, and particularly some of the protons, more shielded. So they'll show up more upfield in my proton NMR. We'll first look at an example of an electron donating group that can push electron density into the ring via the pi system through resonance. So I have a methoxy group as a substituent. The oxygen has 2 bonds and 2 lone pairs. It cannot accept electrons without breaking the octet rule. It can, however, push electrons into the ring. We're going to draw resonance structures to show that. So a lone pair of electrons here can fold down and make a double bond between the oxygen and that carbon. And then in order to not break the octet rule, these pi electrons are going to come out as a lone pair of electrons. So the overall charge on my molecule is 0. And so the overall charge for each of my resonance structures need to be 0. You can see that the oxygen is now positive and the carbon is now negative. Once I'm in the ring, this negative charge can be circulated around the ring. So my arrow will start, I'm going to change colors here so that we can see better. My arrow will start at the lone pair and in the middle of that bond, and then these electrons will kick out. Now, this lone pair can fold in to make a double bond there, and these electrons will come out. And then I can push these in, and I will pop that back out of the ring. And so those resonance structures help me to see where my charges or my partial charges lie in the ring. The presence of that methoxy group pushes electron density on the ring and it localizes it on the positions that are right next door to and across from the substituent. So there's a partial negative at these 2 next door neighbor positions and at the position across. The positions on a benzene ring that are right next to the substituent are called ortho. The position that's 1 away is called meta, and the position that's at the bottom is called para. So an electron donating group pushes electron density into the ring, and that electron density is more localized on the ortho and the para positions. And so those 2 positions are more shielded, and so those signals are going to be more upfield. And the position that's right next door to the substituent generally sees the bigger impact. So on the next slide, we'll sketch the NMR for the aromatic region for this particular molecule. So I've redrawn my molecule here with the protons on it and labeled. There is a plane of symmetry right down the middle of the molecule, that mirror plane, so that you've got identical HAs and identical HBs across from one another on the benzene ring. They're in an identical chemical environment because of that mirror plane. I've also noted the ortho and para positions with the increased partial negative charge because of that electron donating group and its ability to push electron density into the ring via resonance. So The ortho and the para positions, HAs and HCs, should be more upfield than HBs because they have more electron density around them. That electron density creates an opposing magnetic field and will make B felt smaller, and so therefore the range in the chemical shift that these would show up would be at the higher end. So remember, these are on a benzene ring. They're going to show up between 7 and 8-ish, but we're talking about upfield within that range. So HA will be the most upfield. It's the closest to the group. It'll have kind of the biggest impact. HA has one neighbor, HB, so it would be a doublet, but there are two of them, so it'd have an integration of two. That's going to be the most upfield, and it's going to show up more towards 7. HC is going to be the next one because it also has that partial negative charge on it. It has two neighbors, these two HBs. So there's one proton on the carbon on either side. So that's going to be a triplet. So HC is going to be a triplet with an integration of one. There's only one HC, and that's going to show up downfield of HA, but still upfield of HB. HB does not have as much electron density localized on that carbon. Those protons aren't going to be as shielded. And so HB each has two neighbors, right? HB has an HA on one side and an HC on the other side. And so that's going to be a triplet. There are two HBs, and that's going to show up the furthest downfield within this range. So I've just approximated chemical shifts here. But given this molecule, we would expect to see three unique signals because we have three unique protons. And where they show up relative to one another depends on their location relative to the group, the substituent that is on the ring. So the other way that a group can contribute to pushing electron density into the ring is via induction. And so induction is when electron density is pushed into the ring via the sigma framework, so single bonds, the way electrons are shared directly between nuclei, as opposed to a pi framework. So this CH3 group doesn't have any lone pairs of electrons and it can't accept any electrons. So it's just pushing electron density into the ring via the sigma bond. But it doesn't just impact the sigma bond it shares with the carbon it's attached to, but a little bit further on down the way as well. And so an sp3 hybridized carbon is less electronegative than an sp2 hybridized carbon. It has less of an affinity for electrons. So it pushes electron density down into that ring, and you see the biggest impact in the closest proximity to the electron donating group. And so those ortho positions are going to be upfield because of that less electronegative group pushing electron density into the ring. So an electron donating group can either contribute via resonance or via induction. And any group that pushes electron density into the ring provides a more shielded environment and therefore a more upfield signal. The other type of group, generically speaking, that can be attached to a ring is an electron withdrawing group. So an electron withdrawing group is going to pull electron density out of the ring. So instead of pushing it in, it pulls it out. It's going to deshield the protons because there's less electron density around them. And so the signals are going to show up further downfield. And that, again, can be done via resonance or induction. So on the next slide, we'll look at a specific example. So here we have an electron withdrawing group. If we draw the resonance structures for this molecule, we'll see what happens with the electron density. So if you can draw an initial resonance structure that has a positive charge adjacent to the ring, that's always going to be an electron withdrawing group. It can pull pi electrons out of the ring. So now I have a positive charge in the ring. So just like with my negative charge, that can be circulated around the ring. Overall, my charge is still neutral. Your overall charge cannot change in a resonance structure. And then lastly, I can push those back into the ring. And looking here, we'll see that if we look at a kind of an overall total of our resonance structures, we end up with a partial positive charge at the ortho and para positions when we have an electron withdrawing group. So those signals are going to be deshielded and they are going to show up downfield. So more towards 8 in our NMR spectrum. If we sketch our proton NMR, then we remember that the positions that are ortho and para to the electron withdrawing group, so HAs and HCs, are going to be the most deshielded and show up the most downfield. HA is closest in proximity to the electron withdrawing group, so it's going to have an inductive effect that is larger than HC, as well as the resonance effect. So HA is going to be my most downfield signal. It is a doublet because it has one neighbor. Each HA has one neighbor HB, but there are two of them, so the integration is going to be 2. HC is going to be in the middle. It's also deshielded because of that resonance impact. HC has an HB on either side, so it would be a triplet with an integration of 1. That's HC. And then HB is going to also be a triplet, but with an integration of 2. So HB has an HA and an HC on each side of it. And so this arrangement of peaks, the chemical shift of the peaks, is different. So a number of peaks, the integration of the peaks, and the splitting of the peaks is the same for this example and for the first one I gave, but the order of the peaks is different, and that's because of that substituent. Here is an example of a substituent that is electron withdrawing via induction. There's no pi system on that carbon. There's no way to pull electrons out of the ring and onto that carbon. It's sp3 hybridized and it has 4 bonds already, so it can't accept any electrons. But it does pull electron density out of the ring via induction. So again, through that sigma framework, those fluorines are pulling electron density away from the carbon, but it doesn't extend just through one bond. That extends to neighbors as well, but this is definitely a proximity thing. So the ortho positions are going to be the most deshielded and have the biggest impact on chemical shift. So when you are thinking about induction, it's really that proximity that gives you the largest impact. So now let's apply what we know. We know that electron donating groups shield the protons at specific positions to them, especially when resonance is involved. And we know that electron withdrawing groups deshield them. So we can help distinguish signals from one another using chemical shift. And sometimes that's the one distinguishing parameter that allows you to figure out one peak from another. So let's put our protons on this molecule here. So there's a line of symmetry down the middle of this molecule, a mirror plane. So I'm only going to see 2 signals. I'm going to see HAs here and HBs here. Now let's look at each group. This group on the top is an electron donating group. It has a lone pair of electrons on it that can go into the ring and push electron density around. We know that it's going to push electron density to the ortho and the para positions. So those are going to have partial negative charge. Now let's look at the bottom substituent. This is a C triple bond N. N is more electronegative than carbon. It's pulling electron density towards itself, and it can participate in resonance as well. This is an electron withdrawing group. And we know that electron withdrawing groups pull electron density out of the ring at the positions that are ortho and para to them, right? So when we say ortho and para, we're speaking in terms of relative to the substituent, okay? So now I've sort of color-coded my molecule, but I can see that I have positions that are more electron-rich and positions that are less electron-rich. So if I draw my NMR over here, so we're looking at the aromatic region, so 7 to 8 ppm, I can see that the protons that are adjacent to the electron donating group have more electron density around them. They have these partial negatives there. And so those are going to be shielded, and they should show up upfield. So HA each has one neighbor, HB, but there are 2 of them. So HA is going to be a doublet, and it's going to show up more upfield. It's got an integration of 2. Now, again, if I look, these HBs, they have these partial positive charges on those carbons. They're going to be deshielded. So B felt is bigger, and so they're going to show up downfield And so you're going to have more downfield HBs, again, with an integration of two. So you can see in this particular example, I have two peaks. Both of them are doublets, so same splitting. And both of them have an integration of two. So I cannot differentiate those peaks based on the integration or the splitting. I can, however, differentiate them based on the chemical shift. So that's why this is a very important piece of information when solving a puzzle. Sometimes it's the only way that you can tell two peaks apart from one another. So if you can master electron withdrawing groups and electron donating groups and how they influence chemical shift, then you can have a lot of information about the aromatic region of your molecule that you're looking at when you're trying to solve a spectroscopy puzzle. So that's chemical shift in the aromatic region. If you liked this video and you found it helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends. Thanks. See you next time.